This episode is sponsored by Brilliant. Today we'll talk Starship and Super Heavy timeline. How long until SpaceX lights the candle again? Heat shield, tank farm, prototype testing. What's left to do, and can we make an educated guess as to how many more weeks? Yes, we can. Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. We're starting this week with a good amount of work done in Boca Chica. SpaceX is still in the process of testing the Starship for the first orbital flight. Ship 20 and Booster 4 are being prepared for a first test run. Mauricio was up and flying again as always, bringing home some incredible aerial pictures of Boca Chica, Texas and SpaceX's Starbase. Make sure to subscribe to him on YouTube and Twitter and consider becoming his patron. Links are in the description. The great question right now is, what's SpaceX's plan? What are they going to do next? And you best find out by observing them closely, of course. The launch site is progressing fast, and the reason is obvious. The orbital launch is going to take place here, and this is the main instrument to perform the mission with. Launch support tower and launch mount, for example, each are arguably more complex than a Starship prototype itself. The whole ground beneath the structure is full of pipes and cables. Everything is connected and needs to work as intended for the Starship to be able to take flight. SpaceX is constructing the launch mount. The pad below the six pillars is receiving another layer of concrete. Maybe even a small flame diverter system. Here the problem is all about height. The more you construct under the launch table, the less distance you will have between the firing Raptor engines and the surface of whatever you're building below. So adding more concrete under the pad to make it more resilient against the 29 engine blast at ignition makes the surface stronger, but in return it also raises it, increasing the blast strength from the engines. Not an easy fix here. SpaceX will have to be smart. The launch support tower is being worked on as well. Fleshing out has begun. More and more cables and raceways are starting to go up and down the large structure on site. The structure on top is swarming with work. Preparations for the catch system are being made. Elon Musk confirmed again that it will indeed try to catch Booster and Ship in short succession on future recoveries. No legs are needed either for Super Heavy or for the Starship upper stage until we go for Moon and Mars. And these are all the tool attachments for the tower right now. The fueling arm on the right, recently painted black. A large pivot hinge is attached by now. It will be able to swivel out of the way completely, possibly even fold all the way back against the tower. The two chopsticks are taking shape too. Those will catch the Super Heavy booster and Starship. Or at least they'll try. Remember, this is all work in progress. A bit like playing KSP, just with a lot of background knowledge. These guys are no amateurs. Just to give you a sense of scale, this is one of the chopstick hinges. It's a picture by Philip Botten from Twitter, and there's a boot print visible on one of the tubes. This gives you an excellent sense for the scale of these chopsticks. Those hinges will have to hold the weight of a Super Heavy booster or a Starship on a catch attempt. The sled in the middle is partly covered with an improvised tent. These wind covers normally are put in place if lots of welding needs to be done. In between the landing pad where SpaceX workers are right now assembling the catch system and suborbital pads A and B, where Booster 3 was sitting until Sunday, the crew is busy laying down a large new foundation. More dirt is about to disappear, making the site cleaner and more finished. This might be the place where SpaceX could move their suborbital pads to, or at least install more testing equipment like a new load tester. There are a lot of pipes laying around the foundation work. This place will likely be connected to the fuel farms. As just mentioned, Booster 3 is no more. It's been chopped into pieces and taken down. Another sign for SpaceX not wanting to wait around. This frees up space for Booster 4 and Ship 20, and for some needed cryo tests in the near future. Another big project at the launch site right now seems to be Starship 20 heat shield inspection and construction. Workers have begun to mark each and every tile they've already inspected. Red means bad, green means good. Lots of tiles that were cracked got removed and are waiting for a replacement. To make this design rapidly reusable, SpaceX will have to come up with a heat shield that needs minimal inspection. The machine to produce and to install this heat shield will be insanely hard to make. John Winkup was out in the field for Y again and made some exclusive shots of what seems to be SpaceX's TPS-style bakery in Florida. Yup, Elon has his own bakery. Space cookies are a thing now. This is the place on Google Maps. It's actually right across the street from where I stayed in Florida last year. If I remember back now, I thought it smelled nicely from across the road, but of course SpaceX is not baking bread there. They are baking ceramic heat tiles. As you can see in John's pictures, piping and chemical installations are visible. All added recently. Florida, where the Ron John Surf Shop and Mars Exploration are next door to each other. This is the place where thousands upon thousands of these heat tiles, some very specifically shaped, will have to be made and optimized in the future. This is where those tiles you see on the ship here are made. It's an excellent example for SpaceX not having given up on Florida at all. The plan still is to also launch starships out of KSC, out of the cradle of the American space industry. Thank you, OceanCam, for making this awesome video. It shows the immense task of creating a fully reusable heat shield of this size perfectly. For a short turnaround, these tiles have to be quickly replaced and very durable. This red and green marking cannot be part of the final design. It takes days to inspect every tile by hand. The orbital tank farm, as seen here in Mary's wonderful video for NASA spaceflight, is in the final steps of assembly now. It's seen several pressure tests lately. The GSE tanks and the cryo shells on top are being finished and tested for flaws in the construction. I've heard a question many times now, if the orbital fuel farm was too close to the action. Only a few feet away from where starships will lift off and equally close to the landing site, it does seem like a valid question. There can only be one real explanation for it. SpaceX seems confident in the strength of the tanks and in the Starship not exploding that much. Is this just risky thinking? Would you have built the fuel farm further away? As always, tell me in the comments. Next up, we'll get to answer the question as to how long we will still have to wait for that first orbital flight. So stay tuned. The Y family needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe, and share it with your friends on Twitter or Facebook to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Looking for a more direct way of support? Become a Patreon or YouTube member by clicking the join button right under the video and get some awesome perks. Gain access to our Discord server where you can meet me and the rest of the community or get a completely ad-free release of each and every episode provided just for channel members. Or do you know about the Y Warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt, hoodie or cap and look as awesome as you feel. Links can be found in the description. You rock! So how long do we have left? How many more nights will we have to sleep for the next hype train? How long until Ship 20 and Booster 4 take to the skies? It's hard to say, of course. There still are a few things missing until we can see this. The tower needs to be finished, the heat shield needs to be complete and without any tiles missing. Both prototypes need to be tested. All this alone is at least worth 2 to 3 weeks. Lots of work still needs to be done on the tank farm. There can't be any loose or unfinished equipment laying around on the ground. All in all, from what we can observe, I'd say early to mid-September. Musk recently gave an update on Twitter as well. First orbital stack of Starship should be ready for flight in a few weeks, pending only regulatory approval. There it is again, regulatory approval. The FAA needs to green light the orbital Starship. They've gotten better at dealing with SpaceX's development in the past years, but it still isn't a fast process. The tower still needs an environmental assessment, the booster and the ship itself need to be green lit as well. Not only the launch, but also the landing is a complex task to green light for the FAA. Water landings in two different locations. About 100 kilometers northwest of Kauai, Hawaii in the Pacific Ocean for the ship and approximately 50 kilometers off the shore of Boca Chica in the Gulf of Mexico for the booster. Mechazilla, as seen here in this wonderful animation, won't be part of the first flight. A few substances inside booster and ship are toxic. SpaceX will have to ensure that nothing bad can happen on re-entry. If something goes wrong, the debris needs to be on a safe trajectory. Tons of open questions and even more problems to solve. Musk added to his time estimate that he does mean real time and not the famous Elon time. For those who do not know, that's when Elon says it'll be done in a week and then it takes an undefined amount of time longer to finish the task. He seems to be confident though. So, a few weeks most likely is something from 3 to 6 weeks. I strongly believe that it can't be done quicker, and if it was longer, he would have said a few months and not weeks. So, we have a solid chance of an orbital flight in September. As soon as I know anything more, I'll let you know right away, of course, and until then, please tune in on the next episode to find out more. Thanks for watching. Now let's talk Brilliant. I have a golden rule for sponsors. I only accept those who I actually and personally like. Brilliant definitely is one of them. And you've heard me talk about Brilliant before and how it helps you learn STEM. Recently, Brilliant has upped the interactivity on their platform to a whole new level. Take this lesson of the Pythagorean theorem, for example. You might remember from school what the formula is, but in this lesson, you're not just getting an explanation, you're getting a way to see it for yourself. You're moving around triangles and proving for yourself that a squared plus b squared is equal to c squared. And there's much more where that came from. In case you didn't know already, Brilliant is a website and app built of the principle of active problem solving. You learn best while doing and solving things in real time. Jump right into solving problems and be coached bit by bit until, before you even realize it, you've learned a new subject in STEM as you've never seen it before. I personally use Brilliant for my own research for Y episodes all the time. Just pick a course you're interested in and get started. Feeling stuck or made a mistake? You can read the explanations to find out more and learn at your own pace. If you'd like to join me and a community of 8 million learners and educators today, click the link in the description below or visit brilliant.org/whataboutit. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Kevin Randall, Victor Chandra, Lucian Mahi Purici, Lorenzo Patricio Ramos, Richard Collings, 180, David May, Thomas, Clayton Colvin, Ren Cariano, and many others. You rock so much. Without you and countless others, we wouldn't produce this content. So the entire team's gratitude is yours. Make sure to hop on our supporter exclusive Discord to join more than 1,000 spaceflight enthusiasts and to give me a chance to thank you in person. Today's team shoutout goes to the website team for being on the final stretch before the release. Diane, Timo, Sammy Oscuro, Heisi, Alex Burning Corner, Sunny, Alex Potvin, Tony Bela, the list goes on. It's just incredible to see what a group of people with a goal can achieve. I don't even know what to say. You can expect a first version of the new website by mid to late September if everything goes as planned, and it'll blow your mind. You guys rock. This is the place on Google Maps. It's actually right across the street from where I stayed in Florida. They are baking their suborbital pets too, or at least, what the hell? Yeah, lots and lots of tiles, come on. They are not baking bread, they are.